Thank you, Laurette. Thank you, all organizers, for giving me a chance to visit Carjazz again. So today, I'm going to talk about irreversibility and singularities, and the experimental part of the work was done throughout the team Exploit. So the experimental part of this work was done throughout the team Exploit with all these people. The log lattice part was done in collaboration with Ciro Campolina and Alexei Malibev from Brazil, and with this student. And the numerical simulation part of this work was done with Simon Talabar, Vijwanat Shukla, Giorgio, and Sergei. So since we are a school, let me start slowly and start about and define what I mean by irreversibility or reversibility. If you start from Navier-Stokes, which I recall it here, there are two limits in which you can observe some sort of reversible dynamics. The first limit is if you have a very viscous flow, we call it a creeping flow or a Stoke flow. In that case, this term dominates among all the others, and you have a kind of equilibrium between dissipation and forcing. And now I will show a little movie that maybe all of you know, but in the context of this school, it's nice to see it again. So inside this little cylinder, people have put a very viscous flow, probably some sort of glycerol. And this device is in fact a Taylor-Couet flow. It is a cylinder flow. Inside you have a cylinder that can be moved with this little handle. And you can control the velocity at which you move and the direction to which you move. So here, you notice that after putting some dye, the experimenter is driving in one direction and very slowly. This is important because you want to ensure that at each time you are in equilibrium and you don't drive too much movement inside the flow. And in fact, inside the flow, there is virtually no velocity motion. The flow is very quiet. And so the kinetic energy inside the flow is very small. So now, as you see, the experimenter has started turning in the opposite direction. So we have changed the force from F to minus F. And so it goes again very slowly. And what you see is that the mixture that was completely mixed is now becoming completely demixed. And in the end, you recover exactly the same initial condition than in the beginning. So this is an illustration of a reversible dynamics. Can I go back to my presentation? Okay, this was the first limit, the creeping flow limit. As I told you, at each time the flow was in equilibrium, total energy, kinetic energy within the flow is almost zero, is zero, and the creeping flow dynamics was obeying this reversible symmetry when F done minus F and U done minus U, but velocity was very small, then everything goes back. There is actually a second approximation in which you can have some reversible dynamics, and it's a totally different one. You do now nu tends to zero. You don't put any forcing. And then you have this equation, which is the Euler flow. And you notice that this flow, this equation, where here u is missing, is reversible, is invariant against the transformation t done minus t and u done minus u. So this symmetry, I will call it the time reversal symmetry. And the Euler flow, I call it reversible, and it's also described an equilibrium dynamics, because since there is no viscosity, energy is constant at all time. So if you start from some initial condition with a given energy, the energy will be constant. The energy will be constant, but it doesn't mean that nothing happens in the flow. If you look at what is going on, starting from some initial condition, for example here, a Taylor Green vortex, and here I take the opportunity to thank Juan Ignacio, who made a special numerical simulation of this just for me. So what is going on? You start from initial conditions that are very large scale, with the given energy. And then you let the flow evolve according to this equation. And what you see is that there are smaller, smaller and smaller structures that are formed. And what you notice is that at the beginning, the flow was very, very smooth. But after some time, the flow got very corrugated and very complicated. And this is because you want to conserve energy. You want to conserve energy, but with smaller structures. So to make sure that this happens, you need to have more structure, and you need to, in some sense, fractalize the flow. So this is another interesting limit. And in between, now, if I consider Navier-Stokes equation with all the terms, you notice that if I consider this transformation apply, this part of the equation is invariant under this transformation, but of course, this part does not, because it becomes a minus sign when you apply this transformation. And then even if you have a forcing that is reversible under this condition, then the viscosity breaks the time reversal symmetry. So Navier-Stokes, I will say that Navier-Stokes is irreversibility, and it is in non-equilibrium due to viscosity and forcing. And because of the presence of this viscous term that makes the dynamics irreversible, there is entropy production and so dissipation. To compute this dissipation, there are some situations where it's easy to do, even experimentally, is where we consider now non-equilibrium stationary states on Navier-Stokes equation. Non-equilibrium stationary states are interesting because they correspond to a situation where the work done by the force here is in average equivalent to the dissipation due to viscosity, which is shown here. So here I show you an example of a numerical simulation. Here in red, you have the energy input into your DNS. In blue, you have the energy dissipation. So what you will notice is that there is a shift in between, it's important. The energy production arrives a little bit before the energy dissipation. On average, they are the same order of magnitude, but when you add them, they are exactly equal to these green things, which is the variation of the time variation of the kinetic energy. And how do you recognize a non-equilibrium stationary state? It's a situation like this, where the total energy, kinetic energy within the flow fluctuates, but on average, it remains constant. Okay. And in this situation where you have stationary states, this quantity, which is the energy input, which I call it epsilon I, will exactly equal the dissipation. So it's not so easy to measure both independently if you are in an experiment. It's easy in a numerical simulation like this. We were able to do that in the Schreck experiment that Bernard showed you last week. And I'm not sure whether you showed this beautiful plot. This plot is a measurement of, in blue, you measure this quantity for different operating conditions. And we are able to do that because the whole experiment is very well calorified. We measure every heat that is escaping. And in red, you have the energy input. And you can see that within 10%, which is experimental uncertainty, they are equal. Why is it interesting? Is because now it gives us a protocol to measure the energy dissipation. That is, we impose the forcing at a given viscosity. So we impose this at a given viscosity, and we measure epsilon I that is needed to maintain the energy constant, to have a curve like this in the variation of the total energy. 2 minutes ago, I mentioned that there is a shift in between the energy production and the energy dissipation. What is the meaning of this shift? The meaning of this shift is very interesting because now if I do an energy spectrum, I try to measure what energy is contained in a small volume of typical size 1 over k. Then I have the typical cascade of energy, which this typical cascade of energy in the Kolmogorov picture of turbulence, it arises because you somehow force some movement at large scale. You create some big vortices that become smaller and smaller and smaller until they reach the size where the viscosity takes on and where the energy can be dissipated into heat. And so in this process, it takes some time to go from here. This is a cascade time. And this explains the shift between the energy production and the energy dissipation. This time here, this lag, is just the time it takes for the cascade to go from the large scale to the small scale. This is the first remark. The second remark is that in this process, going from large scale to small scale, you somehow store energy within your flow. In fact, a turbulent flow is just a storage of energy. To my knowledge, it has never been suggested for the energy transition, but you know, maybe it's a thing to think about. Anyway, so this you have some storage of energy E, and so you can define a kind of efficiency of a turbulent flow, which is just the ratio of the typical mean energy that you get in your flow by this process divided by the force over Ki, which is the intensity of the forcing that you put. Okay, this measure efficiency of turbulence. I put some forcing. How much does it allow me to store some energy? So this is not too much introduced in turbulence usually, but keep this in mind because I will use it heavily in the last part, in the second part of my talk. Okay, so because we have some non-equilibrium stationary dynamics in experiment, it's very easy to measure this quantity by measuring this quantity because the two, on average, are equal. So this is what we did in the von Karman experiment. And probably this curve, you saw it from Bernard. I'm sorry, I was not there, so I'm not sure what Bernard showed and didn't show. And we were able to observe something which is very well known in turbulence, is that this is even called the zeroth law of turbulence in the Fritsch book, is that dissipation does not depend on viscosity for large enough Reynolds number. So what does it mean? It does not depend. Here you have the measurement we did in the von Karman flow as a function of Reynolds. I remind you, Reynolds is 1 over nu. So at the beginning, for low value of Reynolds number, we observe a dissipation that goes like 1 over Reynolds. This means that the energy dissipation is proportional to nu. This is somehow intuitive because, as I told you, nu is responsible for the symmetry breaking, for the irreversibility. So if you ask someone in the street, how should the energy depend on the viscosity? It will tell you, oh, okay, viscosity creates the energy dissipation, so you should have something proportional. So in this area, we are safe. There is something we understand easily. Everything is fine. And then suddenly, after a certain Reynolds number, turbulence sets in, and you start to see a flattening of the energy dissipation. That is, it becomes independent on viscosity. And if you think heavily, this is something very strange because viscosity is creating the irreversibility, but the consequences of this irreversibility is independent on viscosity. So in the language of statistical physics, phase transition, this is an example of a spontaneous symmetry breaking. That is, normally in the limit nu tends to zero, the equation should become reversible. But even so it is reversible, you have entropy production. Okay? So this is something very strange, and it really excited a lot of people. And the first guy who got excited about this, no wonder, was, of course, Lars von Sagger in 1949. You know that Lars Onsager was the guy who computed the exponent of the easing model. And in the easing model, you have an example of spontaneous symmetry breaking by reversing spin up and down. Okay. So it's no wonder that Onsager understood that it was something special. But he was so smart that he even invented a concept. He said this sentence to in a letter, in three dimensions, there is a mechanism for complete dissipation of all kinetic energy, even without the aid of viscosity. Okay, so at the time where he did this sentence, it was in 1949, he said this in front of an assembly of eminent turbulent scientists like this. And they all looked at him like this and said, okay, so what? What do you mean? Nobody at this time understood what he was meaning. You know, he was 50 years in advance. Yes? This I'm not sure. All I'm sure. Yeah. I mean, you remember that Kolmogorov, he came in Europe in 1961 for this famous Marseille conference. And so people had vaguely heard about the theory, but they only tried to measure it in 1962 on the boat in the Seymour Island. So I think it was somehow separated. But anyway, Onsager, he even did a derivation amounting to this in some sense. But at the time, nobody understood what he meant. And in the meantime, mathematicians did a lot of work. And they understood this, of course, and they understood it. But in 2000, Jean Duchon and Raoul Robert realized that in 2000, most of people working in turbulence still did not understand this, while now there was a rigorous mathematical explanation. So what Duchon and Robert did in 2000, they just made a very pedagogical paper in which they derived essentially what Lars Onsager was saying this and saying in this note. And they do it very pedagogical, removing all mathematical language that usually makes that we understand nothing. And it worked because starting from this time, people working in turbulence understood what it was meant and started to work the consequences of this. So what was Lars Onsager saying? Essentially, what Lars Onsager was saying is that as you saw, turbulence, if you have seen a picture, it's very irregular. There are a lot of very small motions. And so we cannot assume that turbulent flows are fully regular, which means that there are some mathematical consequences. When you do energy budget, like the one I did before here, to get this budget, you do some integration by part, and so then you use boundary condition and you remove term. If the solution is irregular, you cannot do that anymore. You cannot do integration by part as you want, etc. You have to take some precaution. And the precaution, there is actually a mathematical theory to do that. It's called the weak formalism. It's a whole mathematical thing. Mathematician here use it actually to do some numerical integration, like Yonut mentioned it. When he was speaking about his scheme. And using weak formalism, you are able to derive this local energy budget for turbulence. So these local energy budgets are some terms that you already know. You know, this is the variation of the kinetic energy. This is the flux of energy which is advected by the flow. This is the dissipation of energy. But in this energy budget, there is a new term here, D of U, that probably some of you never have seen before. And what is D of U? It's the limit as L tends to zero of the gradient of a test function of width L. So this gradient of this test function really comes from the weak formalism. It is a way to be able to handle functions that are very singular. And so it is the product of the gradient of a regular test function multiplied by the third order, the third power of the velocity increment here. Why it is a weak formalism is that you notice that if the velocity field is very regular, you don't want and you cannot make any differentiation on it. You cannot put a gradient over this quantity, which might be singular. And so what you do is that you put the gradient on some test function and you multiply by this. So it's a sort of making a gradient of this quantity, which is regular, but regularized. Okay. So now what is interesting to see about this term is that if the velocity increment goes like L to the H, in the limit L tends to zero, then power content just tells you that D of U is a limit as L tends to zero of L3H minus 1. The 3H comes from here and the minus 1 comes from the gradient. Okay. In most cases that people consider so far, they consider that the velocity field was regular. If the velocity field is regular, then H is necessarily equal to at least 1 because you can do a Taylor expansion of this quantity. And if H is equal to 1, I plug it into E3H minus 1 is L square. And so the limit L tends to 0 of D of U is 0. You don't have any term like this, and then you recover what you knew, we are safe. But if the H is not necessarily equal to 1, if the fluid is irregular, it can be less than 1. And then we see something very interesting appearing, is that, of course, if H is greater than 1/3, this exponent here is positive, and the limit L tends to 0 is equal to 0, so you don't have any contribution. So you have an irregular field, but which produces no dissipation. I call it weak solution, weak non-dissipative solution. And most interesting, if H is less or equal to 1/3, and I remind you that 1/3 is exactly the exponent that is needed to get the K minus 5/3, then you see that D of U is bounded by a term that does not go to zero anymore, and so D of U can be positive, and you can have dissipation in your flow due to singularities. And as you notice, in this expression, there is absolutely no viscosity. So you have here a mechanism of dissipation of kinetic energy even without the aid of viscosity. So in this remark, Onsager, in fact, he conjectured a link between irreversibility and singularity and between the spontaneous symmetry breaking and singularity. So now, so it was a conjecture in 1949, but now it has been proved by mathematicians. There is no doubt that Onsager conjecture is true, at least for when U is equal to zero, this conjecture is true. Okay, so we have singularities, and the first thing that you will ask, we have singularities. We can have singularities of Euler or quasi-singularities of Navier-Stokes or even maybe singularities of Navier-Stokes. And so when you are in front of this, the first question you ask is, can I see these singularities? Can I see this very irregular place where dissipation could become independent of viscosity? So the nice thing is that this function D of U that I told you here, it is the limit of a quantity that is very simple to compute if you have some velocity measurement, and that can be seen as a scalar, which is a regularity indicator. I call it D I of L. Why? It's because I know that, because of this estimate, I know that if this quantity goes to zero as L tends to zero, I'm sure that I have a regular flow. Okay? So I do the opposite. I say I'm going to look at places where this quantity does not go to zero when L tends to zero. So here is an example of the kind of measurement we do. We take a velocity field like this that we acquire in our experiment. What we see here is a movement of 40,000 particles moving with the flow and colored by velocity. We use this velocity field, we compute this for different scale of pi, and we look at the quantity D of R. And what you see is that there are places where when I decrease L, this quantity does not tend to zero, you know? It points towards some things. And so this quantity here, DIL, is a kind of finger of God that points you in your fluid toward places where it might be irregular. Great, so we have a detector, so we apply it. So now, because you are all tired, let's play a little bit movie. That was done by Abhishek Hare Krishnan, and that was presented at the Gallery of Fluid Motion. So Here you see a numerical simulation. We did that both in experiment and numerical simulation. Here you have a beautiful numerical simulation of our experiment that was performed by Hugues Faller, Caroline Nord, Jean-Luc Guermont in Saclay. What you see here is that you have a lot of vorticity structure, and somewhere in this mess, there is quasi-singularity. So how are we going to find them? This is what I'm telling you. We take the local energy budget, and we will consider this term and look as a function of scale of areas where this scale is very big. So now you will show an example of measurement of this in our flow. So here he is just explaining what is going on. So now you have some cuts of our of the experiment, and you have computation of the orb air at different scales, big scale, smaller scale. And you see that even at small scale, there are locations where you have still some very large value of these indicators. So some parts are on the border, maybe it's a problem, but some parts are inside, and they are very important. And let us concentrate, for example, on this event. Here you have a very high value of this indicator. So let's look now to which kind of vortices it is associated. On green, you see the vorticity, and on red, you see the indicator which takes very large value. So we do a close-up. So you see that the indicator is near two vortex that seems to interact. And what is going on exactly? Now we have only the two vortex. You see that they sort of try to sort of reconnect and do something. Is it a reconnection? Yes, because if you measure the three components of vorticity, you see that at the time where the indicator is the largest, you have a swap of the different components of vorticity, and this is a proof of reconnection. We did the same. We played the same game in the experiment, so images are not so good, because. But we see the same thing is that at the time where the two vortex seems to interact and the indicator is very big, we have a swap of different components, and this means that this is reconnection. And this is an illustration of what is going on in the experiment, and you clearly see the two vortices interacted. Of the order of Kolmogorov. Here we observe the of the order of 5 Kolmogorov, but now we are trying to go to Kolmogorov over 5. We try to gain one order of magnitude by going to the big experiment. Okay, so now we are happy because we have seen places where the flow is the most irregular. It's probably connected to reconnection. And so the question is that, is there any way we can capture these quasi-singularities and weak solutions except that just looking like this? Is there any way we can do something to capture all this from a consistent way? So there are a lot of students here. So you say, wow, I mean, what do you mean? Is it so difficult? Let's take a numerical simulation and let's run it. For example, I take a layer. A layer equation, I take do, and then I run it. So fine. So this is the thing by Juan Ignacio. You see first there is formation of this kind of sheets that are very singular, formation of very small structure, and then suddenly you see something strange appearing and some fog appearing in your numerical simulation. Is this fog the signature of the singularity? I mean, did we find some singularity? No. Unfortunately, what you are going to see, what you are seeing here, is finite size effect. If you look at the energy spectrum, and here is an energy spectrum which is not taken from this seminal paper, because it was Marc Etienne and his student, and especially also Giorgio, who realized that, is that if I look at the energy spectrum corresponding to this, it first starts as a nice spectrum, but after some time, you see there is this little tail that develops, and then it grows larger and larger, and in the end you get a K square law that invades all your spectral space, and in the end you get only K square, which is this fog. What is this K square? This K square is the signature of the fact that your small scale at some point they hit a wall here. You have a wall in the scale space, and they cannot become any more smaller, you know, because there is just no room. So what do they do? They do, we are blocked by the wall. So they talk to each other, and the best way they can do is just to exchange energy in between all of them to be all equal, you know. Turbulence is very communist, and in the end, if you cannot move inside the box, you just distribute energy evenly among all participants, and then you get what is called a thermalization. So if you run a finite size Euler equation, and it's the same thing for Navier-Stokes, maybe some of you who have done numerical simulations, they know that if you don't resolve enough your Navier-Stokes, in the end, you have this little k square tail, which is a signature that your simulation is not well enough resolved. This is also happening, and it was shown also by the Marketian and Alexandro Alexakis. Okay, the explanation for this was given by the group of Frisch and Sergei. So if you have some question about this, you can talk to Sergei, who is here, and who will explain this much better than me. What could be happening is that this thermalization comes from interaction of a complex singularity, so a singularity which is in the complex plane, who would like to move towards the real axis to be a real singularity. So it stays at the distance delta from the wall. And as soon as your resolution is of the order of the size of this distance to the wall, then problem happens and you have thermalization. And if you want to avoid this, you need the Kmax to tend to infinity so that your singularity can go towards the real axis and develop into a real singularity. It's a kind of hand-waving explanation, but for the purpose of this talk, it's enough for me for the rest of the talk. Okay, so if I want to see development of singularities and see how they really look like, somehow I have to find a way to push this Kmax as far as possible. And as you know, in numerical simulation, it's not so easy. It's not so easy because usually what we use is this kind of discretization. We are also very communist in turbulence, and so what we like is to put an equal weight to all scales, and so the best way to do that is, for example, if you do a simulation in a Fourier space, then you cut your space into nice pieces that are exactly the same size. So it's a linear grid. But as you know, going to infinity using a linear grid, it takes n points. You know, if you want to go to 1 to n using a linear grid, it takes n points. So these two guys, Campolina and Malibeev, they had a nice idea, was to generalize some idea which was already used in shell model to do something else, is to do a projection of your equation on a log grid. Okay, so now you don't, your aim is not to fully completely simulate your flow. You just want to simulate only some of the modes. And you choose these modes in a way so that you can go very fast with a very few number of modes to the smallest scale possible. So you can do it quite easily using what I call a log grid, in which the wave number, instead of being proportional to m, they are proportional to lambda to the m, where lambda is some number. Okay. By the way, the same idea was used, for example, by Anna somewhere, where they tried to decimate this grid using fractal decimation, and some of the results we obtained are in fact similar to what they obtained. But in our case, it's a systematic projection. And the advantage of this is that because it is a systematic projection, we keep all symmetric properties of the equation. This is the first advantage. The second advantage is that it's a well-defined projection, so there is no adjustable parameter except the value of lambda, which is the step of your grid. Okay. The third advantage is that it's very fast now to go towards small scale, and we will be able to reach very small scale with a very small number of modes. These are the three advantages. The difficulty is that projecting from a regular grid to a log grid has some inconvenient, and the inconvenient comes from the convolution product, which appears whenever you have non-linear terms. Because you know, When you perform a convolution, you need to close triangles of the grid. So closing triangles of the grid has a lot of solution. It's very easy on linear grid. But in log grid, if you consider the spacing, it's not so easy to close triangle. And in fact, there are only an infinite but denombrable number of value of lambdas for which it's possible. So the two most important values of lambda are the value lambda equal to 1.35 and 1.63, the golden number and the plastic number. And you see as they go towards lambda equal 1, you have more and more interaction in between the different modes. But the difficulty with log grid is that all the interactions are local. So the log lattice projection, in fact, removes on all the non-local interaction. But apart from this, apart from the fact that we have removed all non-local interaction, this projection keeps all the symmetry properties of the equation and all the conserved quantity. So let me show you right now why it is interesting. Let's do the same things than before. You know, I run Euler equation, not on a real grid, where at some point very fast I will have some problem of resolution and some thermalization. Let's run it on a log grid. What is happening? Already you see very interesting things is that here I show you we have been able to run, in fact this is Kampolin and Meilibayev who did it first, but we just reproduced this result. We have been able to run this on grid up to 10 to the 15, even 10 to the 20 or 10 to the 30. Okay, very big grid, very big grid. And what you see is that the energy spectrum, it develops, it does not hit any wall, so it can develop very fairly. And what you see is that it takes a self-similar shape as time increases. And the three different colors here are three different values of lambda. So you see that it does not depend on the value of lambda. And it develops a nice k minus 7/3 during the blow-up. Why do I speak about the blow-up? Is that if I look at the maximum of the vorticity during these things, here I plot it 1 over the maximum of vorticity as a function of 1 minus t over tb, where t is the blow-up time, in fact, you see that you have power laws. Okay? The power laws amplitude depends on the value of lambda, but the slope does not. So again, we look in the grid, in the grid, but here you will see. Okay, so this is kx, kx, ky, and we project on some value of kz, and we look at omega k, the maximum of omega k over the whole grid. Yes, here. I don't make the link with BKM. I just say that the maximum amplitude is going to infinity. You have some blow up in the spectral space. Okay, so just to tell you, the simulation I was showing you was some pixel here. Okay, it was here in the space. The biggest simulation of Euler is here. Okay, and this is what you can get with log lattice. So what you see here is the amplitude of the different vorticity modes as a function of time during the time where this blow up develops. And you see that little by little, there is some kind of structure that is appearing. So Kampolina and Meilibayev showed that this is, in fact, a chaotic attractor. The color is just the maximum of the mode. And what is very interesting is that this attractor is really an attractor because you see this sort of V shape that is propagating towards larger and larger wave number in space, but it keeps its shape. You know, it's a kind of glider that goes from small scale to large scale. And you see why log lattice are interesting, because if I had a DNS, I would be stuck into heat, and I would never have seen this glider develop, and I'm not able to see this nice power law. Okay? Okay, so we know that on log lattice, on Euler, there is a singularity. You notice that it corresponds to H equal 2/3. It's a non-dissipative singularity. So there is a self-similar blow-up in finite time. But the problem with blow-up is that you have blow-up in finite time. Everybody is wondering what is happening after blow-up. You know, what is becoming? Do we have some weak solution that is organized? So it's a whole thing, and the situation is not settled right now. So we thought about some other way to try to reach the weak solution. And so we introduce, in that process, we introduce a new equation, which is called the reversible Navier-Stokes equation. This equation was first introduced by Galavotti in 1996. he used it for trying to derive some equilibrium theorem and some some equivalence theorem. But you can use it here. We use it to try to understand the physics of these singularities, of these quasi-singularities, and of weak solution. So what is a reversible Navier-Stokes? You see that it has just the same structure as Navier-Stokes, except for this new, that now is allowed to vary with time, so that at each time, you conserve exactly the energy. Okay, the energy now is fixed. So doing that, we are since viscosity vary, we cannot use Reynolds number as a control parameter. So we introduce a new parameter, which is connected to the FHC, is 1 over the FHC. We call it RR, and it's just the ratio of the forcing that we impose. This is something you impose, and the energy that you want to impose in your flow. Okay, and then the viscosity is just to computed so that this parameter remains constant. And here is the interest in that, you know, in Navier-Stokes, I showed you that there is an injection of energy, there is dissipation by viscosity, but there is maybe a third term which comes from weak solution. And when you measure energy injection, it's not so easy to disconnect the two. While here, it's very interesting that we have two situations. If there is no anomaly, the reversible viscosity that we need to put into the flow to maintain it constant is just the ratio of the energy production to the entropy. Okay, but if there are some weak solution, you can have a situation where part of the energy is dissipated by irregularity, and then you still have entropy. And you could have situation if you have a weak solution where at a given forcing, you don't need to put any viscosity to maintain the flow at constant energy, because the flow is doing all the job for you. Okay, so by tracking the viscosity and seeing a situation where it goes to zero, it is a sort of way to track the weak solution. So because we wanted to have a lot of resolution, here I will show you log lattice, but with Giorgio, Sergei, Simon, and Vijvanath, we did also something with direct numerical simulation, but the resolution was somehow limited. So let me show you just the result with log lattice. But before I do that, I present you the only result I will present you using numerical simulation is that now I completed my picture that I had at the beginning. So very viscous flow, inviscid flow, Euler flow. And in the middle, now I have added a new reversible thing, the reversible Navier-Stokes, which is reversible with energy constant like this, but which is non-equilibrium, while Euler flow was in equilibrium. And as I will tell you, as I will show you, using this reversible Navier-Stokes, we are able to consider all situations between creeping flow and Euler flow and consider the whole spectrum. So you are all very interesting. What does a reversible Navier-Stokes solution? Well, it depends on the parameter. Here I show you a beautiful movie that was done by Giorgio, in which you see there are some very interesting things. I will come back further into things. It's just a little trailer, so that if Laurette wants to cut me, then you will all beg so that I go further and explain you what you have been seeing. And so we run this reversible Navier-Stokes on a log lattice, and I told you the control parameter is RR, and this is the amount of viscosity we have to put in the flow to keep the energy constant. Okay, so first thing is that it depends on the resolution. So here is the number of log lattice mode per direction that we use, but here is the equivalent in Kmax. So you see that we are reaching very, very fast resolutions that are out of reach of numerical simulation. And here is typically how the curve looks like. At small RR, we have a sort of of slope like this, which is of the order r to the 2. And then suddenly, around some value of r, which is of order 2, it steepens, and it goes toward another branch that seems to be independent on resolution. So you have a part that depends on resolution is here, and here a part that is independent on resolution. What do these different branches correspond? In fact, they correspond to different types of solution. On this left branch here, it corresponds to solutions that have a spectrum like this. They have, for large case, they have a power law spectrum, and for low case, they have a power law spectrum, and for large case, they have a K minus spectrum that correspond in log lattice to thermalization. Because we are in a log grid, thermalization is not correspond not to K2, but to K minus 1. On the other hand, on this branch here, we have solutions that resemble Kolmogorov with a K minus 5 third at large scales and a viscous dissipation. And if you look at the energy transfer, it is here it's not a very good example, but it can be flat over some wave number. So this is Navier-Stokes solution, and this is a thermalized solution with some weird exponent that does not look always to be equal to Navier-Stokes. And in the middle, you have a transition zone, okay? So you have here, I will call, and it is a situation what we obtain with DNS. And I'm not showing you the real value of nu because we all stay in that range of value. On the left, it corresponds to Euler thermalized solution. Here on DNS, you really see that there is a K2 spectrum, and this is the Navier-Stokes spectrum that appears on this kind of branch. And what we check is that this phase is reversible, while this phase is irreversible. So what we actually get using this reversible Navier-Stokes is a phase transition between a reversible phase, which is done with Euler thermalized solution at finite resolution, and an irreversible phase, which is typical of Navier-Stokes, that lies here. And in between, you have this transition. So you have a kind of a transition. Do we have a real phase transition? Well, here is what is happening during in this transition phase. So here, what you will see is the energy spectrum of one of these solutions in this transition zone. So you see that at the beginning, he wants to develop a singularity. Then it hits the resolution here. And then it thermalizes. Okay, so this is the classical thing. It seems that nothing else will be happening. So it thermalizes, it develops a power law, which in this case is close to Kolmogorov. But then if you wait long enough and the first event will occur at t equal 45, so we can wait 10 seconds more, you will see something very strange appearing, is that this thing, which seems to be completely stationary, a reversible thermalized solution, suddenly you will see that the spectrum starts to wiggle, and then it goes down. It goes down, it means that we are transiting towards an irreversible solution, a Navier-Stokes solution, and then it goes back. So it seems that we have oscillation between reversible and irreversible. As in many phase transitions, we have coexistence of two phases, right? So now let's look again at the beautiful picture of Giorgio. We have the same thing, is that at the beginning, it goes a little bit fast. So let me try to... Can I escape for this? Okay, so first you have the development. Well, it's not so nice. First, you have the development of vorticity sheets. Then you see some sort of thermalization. And out of thermalization, suddenly some new structures are occurring. You know, this sort of velocity of vorticity things. So you have this structure. You develop some sort of very small structure. So this is the self-similar blow-up. During the self-similar blow-up, you develop very, very small structure with very, very large vorticity. Then you reach something which is just the appearance of the thermalization. you have some noise here. Here you see the noise, but what is very interesting is that inside the noise, you start to see development of a vorticity sheet, okay? The vorticity sheet is developing, and then the fog clear. Now you see clearly the vorticity sheet. And then after this, from the vorticity sheet, you see development of this filament here that grows and grows. You have a sort of inverse cascade. And in the end, you form again a vorticity sheet. And from this, you form a large scale dynamics and it starts again. Okay, very interesting, reversible. They are the scale of Kmax. But so smaller than Kolmogorov, in some sense. I mean, but because the viscosity is changing. Okay. So during this process, where you go from one solution to the other, you have very huge fluctuation of entropy. Here is the entropy as a function of time. And in this transition zone, this is typically the sort of entropy profile that you have. You have a basic entropy, which is the entropy of the Navier-Stokes, and some huge peak, which correspond to when you go to this blow-up solution and thermalization. And this is organized as a phase transition. That is, if I look at the mean vorticity, you see that as a function of resolution, if you here you have finite size effect, but if you go at larger resolution, you have a very clear laws which has some mean field exponent. It goes like square root of R minus R critical. More interesting, if you look at fluctuation of entropy at the transition, which is around 2, if you have a large enough resolution, you have divergence of the fluctuation. Exactly like in the second order phase transition. Great. So I have 10 minutes more. Okay, so now I have this picture. Something we can ask is, is there anomalous dissipation on this branch? Here is a measurement of energy injection as a function of Reynolds. So you see that here, we are the creeping flow limit. We have energy that goes like 1 over Reynolds, like usual. Then it flattens on this branch, but it's not flat yet. Okay, and as we go toward this branch, then it takes another law, which is due to thermalization. And the question we can ask is that if we go toward this limit here, will this be become completely flat? This we don't know yet. But there is something that is also very interesting, is that in here, in this situation, you see that we have a combination of one spectrum with k, which is equal to one minus 1.5. So minus 1.5 corresponds to an h, which is smaller than 1/3. So this part here of the solution corresponds to a dissipative solution, a weak dissipative solution. And in the end, there is some sort of thermalization. So we have this conjecture, and the conjecture is about what is going on in the infinite resolution. In the infinite resolution, so this branch here, if I continue it here, this branch will collapse here at this point, at 2.5 here. But there is the issue is what is going on here at zero viscosity. And the conjecture is that at this location, we are a space where live Euler dissipative weak solution that are able to dissipate energy even in the absence of viscosity. So what is very interesting is that we try to study what is this exponent, you know? And this exponent here as a function of RR at different resolution, you see that the corresponding exponent goes from Kolmogorov at the point here, but it goes towards the exponent 1, which corresponds to H is equal to 0. So there seems to be a whole connection of Euler dissipative weak solution between Kolmogorov type of solution to H equals 0, which is H mean in turbulence. And in fact, H equal to 0 is a limiting exponent that you can have so that the total energy is finite. So the conjecture is the following, is that in this red line, there live an infinity Euler weakly dissipative solution with exponent varying between 0 and 1/3. This is a conjecture. We cannot prove that. If there are some mathematicians here that can prove this is fine. I will finish by something. Is it possible to observe this weak solution? Well, we have done something equivalent like Euler, but now I remind you with RR equals zero, you have a self-similar blow-up, exponent 7/3. So we have played the same game for different value of RR. Here you have an example of what is going on. So you see that the spectrum is developing. We run it on an adaptative grid, so this is Kmax that moved. So you see we have a very clear exponent that is developing, and for RR equal 2, you see the exponent is -1.9. It's smaller than 7/3. So the self-similar blow-up, this is the exponent as a function of RR. It goes to -7/3 to 5/3 at the critical RR. And in between, it seems that you have a whole theory of possible pre-blow-up exponent. but we cannot go any further. If at some point you stop your Kmax and you see what is happening, this is we play this game. If so, suddenly at some time you block the simulation, even if you start from k-7/3, suddenly what you observe that if you block the viscosity, then another exponent develops, which is k-5/3, which was, by the way, also a phenomenon like this was also observed recently by Fenn et al. Using finite elements, but which are singular or something like this. So we have a second conjecture, is that the scenario to obtain weak solution is the following, and this conjecture is inspired by a very important work by Sergei and a lot of people using differential model of turbulence, is that you can have a situation in which you have a forward self-similar blow-up in finite time with a certain exponent, and then after the time you reach the blow-up, you have development of another solution, a backward self-similar front, which results in another exponent k minus beta. Here is an example in MHD where you go from one exponent to another one, and you see that when you change exponent, then the solution becomes dissipative because suddenly the energy is decaying. Non-dissipative solution, dissipative solution. So we have the conjecture that the same thing happens in log lattice, but we need to prove this, and I'm hoping that Sergei will activate his Russian network to prove this. And so, just for the last minute that is left, since we are in a talk that is bridging classical and quantum turbulence, I want to launch a crazy idea. Is that, as you know, GP equation are reversible. This was Koyabashi was telling us. If you apply the Madelung transformation, you get the quantum hydrodynamic equation, which are also reversible. And what is very nice is that this equation, if you put boundaries, they can blow up in finite time. If they blow up in finite time, then you can have a weak solution. The whole machinery can work again. And so I would suggest that we could maybe study a new model. I call it the R quantum hydro model as a toy model for superfluid. And the model just looks like this. You take the quantum hydrodynamic solution and you add a reversible viscosity to maintain the energy constant. And then you can add any forcing you want because now you can switch the reversible viscosity so that you keep energy constant. So the nice thing about this is that you will naturally have the phase transition because you will have the superfluid phase, which will be on this, the normal fluid phase, which will be here, and in the transition, you have the two fluids, which are coexisting. Okay. The second thing is that, so you identify the superfluid is a weak solution, the normal is a viscous solution, and the sound that you have, well, they could be just the tigers, here. This is the sound that you see. They can be taken by the tigers and by the thermalization of the solution. Finally, what is very nice is that you can have finite dissipation by weak solution, like observed in superfluid. You don't need any other ingredient. You just need to say that this equation can have weak solution, and if it has weak solution, it will dissipate energy even without viscosity. So, and forcing it easy. So, okay, I will stop here. Here is just a summary of all I have been saying. And if there is a few questions, I'd be happy to take them.